Brahma, Gurur Vishnu, Gurur Devo Maheshwaraha, Guru Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. We are in verse number 422 of Vivekachudamani, and the topic that is going on is Atmagyana Phala. Means, what is the result of Atmagyan? What is the result of self-realization, of attaining moksha? So here, last week we saw the first three verses, I think. Third verse we completed, or maybe a little bit. Sansiddhasya phalam tvetata jivan muktasya yoginaha bahirantas sadhanandaha rasa swadanamatmani. The ultimate gain for the jivan mukta yogi, liberated while alive as a result of the firm abidance in the self-knowledge, is that he is ever engaging, tasting and experiencing the eternal bliss in and out through all experiences. See, just like when you wake up from the dream, now your entire being is experiencing the waking body, the waking senses, the waking mind and the waking world, isn't it? There's no question that you can fall back into the dream memories or experience. Exactly the same way, when a realized master or a person seeker, when he gets established in his essential self, then what is he doing? He is taking the rasa swad. Where is the ras coming from? The five senses and the mind, the six senses. So he is enjoying the bliss of what he is seeing. He is enjoying the bliss of what he is hearing. It's not the topic that he is hearing. It's not the topic of what he is seeing. Because when we give importance to the topic or the object, then what happens?
You miss the essence.
More?
Get involved in the
then what happened? Likes and dislikes are created. So this rasa swad which we are talking about of the sons, the siddha purusha, is not the swad or the taste of the objects. It is the taste of the self, because of which seeing is possible, because of which hearing is possible. Not only that, this is first step. Next step will be exactly. The first step is that I am the, he's enjoying the bliss because of which, or the self because of which, seeing is taking place, hearing is taking place, tasting is taking place, thinking is taking place. And the next stage after that is the where it is a one without a second experience. It's a jnana ghana. It is a homogeneous experience of self. Nothing is excluded from it. Sansiddhasya phalam tvetata jivan muktasya yogina. And whom we are talking about? A person who has come to know the self while living, not posthumously. And there are enough examples on this planet who have come to know. You can read their biographies. Even today you can go and meet them. Then next one was Vairagyasya phalam bodho bodhasyo parati phalam swanandanubhavat shantihi eshai voparate phalam. Dispassion leads to experience, and experience leads to indifference to the worldly objects, and this indifference by the experience of the blissful self quietens the mind. So three, this is what the sadhak must do in order to get to the first verse, the vision that was given in the first verse, how a realized master experiences the, what is his disposition. We can't even say self-realized master experiences anything. But the only tool we have is the word. So these shlokas have come about, isn't it? So what should a seeker do? Here is the step-by-step unfoldment of the student or the seeker. What is that? Vairagya safalam bodho. He must cultivate dispassion in life. He must cultivate vairagya. Rag is attachment. Vairagya is non-attachment. Don't live a life full of passion for the objects of the world. And how do you not live a passionate life towards the objects of the world? By looking at the objects and having dosha drishti. In Vedanta Dindima, this topic came, and Panchadashi also it came, I think. Dosha drishti, find faults. We are experts at finding faults with everyone. So find fault with every object. How? It cannot be a source of joy and bliss and happiness for us. Because if I just had dinner, if it was the source of, it was fantastic, pasta. Oh, well, wonderful, wonderful, ha ha, hoo hoo. But after 3-4 hours, I'll be again hungry. And if I keep getting pasta again and again and again, I'll get tired. Something different, isn't it? So it is not satisfying me completely. What we are seeking is complete satisfaction. So vairagya, the initial step is dosha drishti. Dosha drishti, finding fault in the experiences of the world from which we are trying to squeeze out the happiness for ourselves, which is impermanent in nature. In fact, the truth is, the happiness is not at all possible from the objects, because happiness is your nature, isn't it? So when we practice vairagya, what happens? What happens when we practice vairagya before higher knowledge? We don't get involved in the world. Yes. What else? What is the consequence of that?
Detachment.
Yes. Because
mind quietens.
Because less thoughts corrupting the mind. Less thoughts agitating the mind. The sankalpa vikalpa reduces because now you have got no interest in the world. Isn't it? Our life, we want to get up tomorrow morning only for one reason, because we have got agenda. Isn't it? If there is no agenda for tomorrow, let it be work, let it be taking care of children, let it be paying the bills, let it be getting the car serviced, let it be gardening, some agenda is there. But if there is no agenda, no thought fluctuation, mind is calm. So here it says, dispassion leads to experience. And experience leads to indifference. Experience here means knowledge. What knowledge? See, when we think knowledge is gained through scriptures, through listening, through experiencing, through satsang. But all this knowledge is second-hand knowledge. All this knowledge is second-hand knowledge. You listen and afterwards you forget. Then what is that which you have not forgotten? Which knowledge you have not forgotten? Which has emanated in you without a reason? Sometimes things have clicked just like that in your quieter moments, or some experience you are having, or some satsang you are there, or some book you are reading, or some child you are playing with, or something going on. And it's not all the time, but some moments of your life have, at that moment you are completely available, and maybe you are quiet, and in that moment a great realization, whatever its scope and effect, it happened. And you don't forget it. Because you were available. So this is all, when it came from inside, without any prompt from outside, or maybe there was a prompt, but it came from within. It was not, and you were surprised. Oh, wow. Where did it come from? See? Quiet mind. Where does bliss come from? A quiet mind. When object that you are pursuing, once you receive it, or when you grasp it, you grasp it or become one with it, the desire for that particular object stops. And the moment it stops, that bliss emanates, isn't it? Exactly the same way. When vairagya is cultivated consciously initially, it leads to, here it says experience, but the word here is bodhas, vairagya sa phalam bodho. Bodho means knowledge, experience. You become aware, you become conscious, you become alert. Agitated mind cannot be an alert mind. A quiet mind is an alert mind, as long as it's not going to sleep. Understand? So alertness is a condition of the natural condition of the mind. Natural. Thinking is unnatural condition of the mind. What will be the most natural condition of the mind? Mind we are talking about. Quiet mind, in which the moon is shining fully and you are able to see it, isn't it? If it is agitated, you cannot see the reflection of the moon. See, this is our state. So vairagya must lead to an unshakable knowledge about the self. If that is not, and this is in this Vivekachudamani, in the beginning itself, it was told that there are four steps. Vivek, Vairagya, Shatka Sampatti and Mumukshutvam. So the first was Vivek. Vivek is discrimination between real and unreal. And that was followed. And what is this real and unreal? That what I said was Dosha Drishti. That these objects have not been able to fulfill me. So it's the same. I'm talking about my health. Everyone's health is breaking down as they're getting old. Nobody is healthy. What have I been able to hold on to from childhood to today? Nothing. It, as much as I may try, if I try harder, it slips faster. So we have not been able to hold on to anything. Then automatically, why am I pursuing this? Why am I falling into this default? Why am I going after this objective world so passionately? It's not serving any purpose. I'm just going round and round and round and getting caught up. So vairagya comes about. And when the mind becomes calm after some time, after continued practice of non-involvement in the world, consciously not desiring anything from the world, but allowing the world to happen to you. Meaning you cannot stop your eyes from seeing, you cannot stop your senses and mind from thinking and perceiving the world. You cannot. Let it happen. But you are not initiating anything. Then it is vairagya. See? It is not escapism. You are not having vairagya towards the world because because of sickness, because of a difficult wife or a husband.
Virakti.
It is not a reaction to something. I'm not becoming successful. I tried this, I tried that, I tried that. Now what to do? You go to Gangaji, get the cloth, you get plenty. In donation you get it colored and wear it. So that is not sannyas, that is not vairagya, that is escapism. So what is the sign of vairagya? How do you know you have practiced vairagya correctly? It must lead to alertness and knowledge. And what is that alertness and knowledge? Discrimination. You are more focused on the self now. You are more focused on the vivek now. Sat asat. Continuously alert. and it leads to more dispassion. If that is not happening, then vairagya was escapism. Then avairagya was escapism. If you're going to ashrams, you're going to temples, you're going for pilgrimages, is it to enhance your alertness by being in that environment? Is that why you are gone? Is it a calling? Or is it, only you can tell, or is it that you want to run away from your family because it's too much, I can't handle it anymore, or I need a break? Break means escapism. We use it many times, I need a break. Escapism. It is not a healthy condition. So, who is practicing Vairagya? Who is with inspiration living life but not attached to anything that is going on in life? That is Vairagya. We are not running away from anything in life. Science. Otherwise, we'll have a twisted meaning of Vairagya. And if we have been practicing every now and then dispassion, now check, shake yourself up a little, sit quietly, see if mind is quiet naturally. Is there a conviction that the self is, the urge to be with the self, is it there or not? That will come. If the mind has become quiet, it will come. Mind will become quiet if Vairagya is there. All link. One step leads to next. Next one. Bodhasya uparati phalam. Uparati is that indifference to the worldly objects. Just like when you wake up, give you a few examples. When you wake up, are you having any feeling of going back to the dream that you woke up from? No. Why? Total indifference, isn't it? Why? You know you cannot go back. You have the knowledge that you cannot go back, isn't it? And you know that it is a phenomena. So therefore, uparati means indifference, complete zero value in your mind. Indifference is possible only when there is zero value for something, isn't it? Now think another, second example. When you were a child, you were playing with the toys. Now, someone meets you after 70 years, 60 years. Oh, I know you when you were, I remember you enjoyed playing with the car, so I bought you a car from that time, you know. I had by mistake taken it from your home and you cried so much, I was meant to give it back to you, but 60 years have passed now. And you bring the car and give it to that person. What is, stupid fellow will say, oh, thank you very much, it was a very cherished car, I know someone who still plays at 75 years old. He still every day spends 1 or 2 hours cleaning his cars, cleaning his toys from childhood. Pathetic, isn't it? What are you saying about pathetic about him? What about you? At the drop of a hat, you take out your albums from the past and indulge in them. Same thing. Take out the videos from the past. You know, we went there. You know, this photograph. You know, that Kailash. You know, this place. You know, this is how I looked when I got married. You know, this is how I was before marriage. blah, 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 blah. It's exactly the same thing. Swanandanubhavat shantihi eshaivoparate palam. So this indifference by the experience. So experience leads to experience of what? Not about knowledge of the world. Knowledge of the self. See, the two times the word has been used. First it is used bodhasya uparati phalam, and then second verse one is shantihi esha eva uparate. Again uparate. So two times indifference. So first indifference was on account of the knowledge, a deep conviction about the self, and extreme alertness which has come about on account of less objectivity within the mind as a result of vairagya or dispassion. Then a point comes in yoga, they call it as pratyahar. Pratyahar is a stage where the mind of its own accord, even if the senses are open, it doesn't want to go out and get involved in the world. That is the one there. Because now what is happening? You are so, alert about the self. Alert about the self doesn't mean that you have realized the self. But you are completely convinced. And the second take on it can be that the knowledge is not worldly knowledge, it is the knowledge of the self itself. This is the second take of it. So vairagya leads to knowledge of the self. Therefore it says, tyage naike amritatva manashu, that only by tyag, only by dispassion, only by giving up, the amritatva is possible. See? And the second one is, swanandanubhavat shantihi, and as a result, now because no more stimuli of the objective world are corrupting the mind by way of thoughts, the mind is completely available to the self. When it is thinking about the self or the divine theme again and again and again, and eventually it merges. Swanandanubhavat shantihi. That swanunand, as the mind becomes introvert toward its own source, towards the divine theme, to that extent, the bliss, the anand, it keeps filling up the mind. It keeps filling up the being. And once it has completely, as it is filling up, directly proportional to that, your indifference towards the world is your disposition. These things are not practiced, they must happen. You cannot practice indifference without having vairagya and knowledge. You cannot have knowledge without vairagya. Many people say, I know the self, I am very clear about the self. But you see them whole day calculating how much money in the bank. How much do I need more to invest so that I have a better life when I retire?
Is there a difference between the knowledge and application though? Is there a difference in that person who is not applying?
See, our understanding of application is doing something. Here we are
not doing.
Here there is no doing and yet knowledge is taking place. So that knowledge and application is at the worldly level. If you consider yourself to be the body, yes. You are gaining this. At this moment, there are two ways. Either you are completely 100% available to what is being heard and just be with it, with an empty mind, allowing it to do whatever it requires to do, or you will collect the knowledge and then at home will ruminate over it or contemplate over it. Then now you are applying, and that step Shankaracharya says, Shravanam Mananam Nididhyasanam. But if you do Shravanam correctly, Mananam Nididhyasan become absolute. They become absolute. It's not that Shravanam leads to Mananam, leads to Nididhyasanam. Yes, it is a valid step because Master has said it. But they can happen instantaneously also. If you are at this moment available to the self within you at this moment, without any coloring, without any without any bias or judgment, and you cannot come to the self just like that at this moment. So what is happening? You are hearing. So this is why Shravanam is told. You are hearing. So is listening triggering you back to the self? Not at the end of listening. We are talking about while listening. While listening. Because self can be accessed and you can be the self or you are the self every moment. So it's not a posthumous experience after this moment has died. It's not that. It is either now or never. It can never be never, but in one of the texts, I don't know if it was here or in Panchadashi, it comes that put your attention on what is that because of which hearing is possible. If you put attention on that, you are available. Just be aware. It is not that you are asking that question again and again and again and again. Just be available. 100%. See? Then you are listening. Then Mananam Nididhyasana are not required. Then it is naturally happening. The knowledge will naturally happen. It's uncaused knowledge then. So, uparaitai phalam. Then, indifference by the experience of blissful self quietens the mind. And the more you experience the bliss, more the mind experiences the bliss. To that extent, it stops being extrovert because it is experiencing the bliss within. You experience the bliss in the sleep also, isn't it? That's why you want to go back to sleep every night. Because you know somewhere within you that no thoughts is equal to bliss. But there is no swananda. There is no bliss of the... Even though it is the bliss that you are experiencing is from the self, you are unaware of it. Not dream, sleep. You are unaware of it. Here, what is being told, you are alert, you are aware, and the mind is full of bliss. And the consequence of that is your mind is indifferent to what is going on. See? So just like you are right now focused on me, you are indifferent to what is there in this room. Imagine you are completely available to your own self. Mind is... let it be through japa or whatever way, or here it is contemplation, automatically you are unavailable to everything else. That unavailability to anything else is equal to indifference to everything else. Then came yadyuttarotarabhavah purva purvam tu nishphalam nivritti paramatruptihi anando anupama Swataha. If the here the something is told that you cannot straight away jump to the last one. One first one leads to the next, next leads to the next, next leads to the next. Just because you want to, your tummy becomes full by the eighth chapati, you cannot eat the eighth chapati and say my tummy is full. It will not happen. Understand? Or if you know you have to go through all the year 12, 1 to 12, 12 years, And then you have to go through 3 years of uni, then 2 years of masters, then 3 years or 4 years of PhD. No, I want to do PhD straight away. What will you do when you reach PhD? If you get into that class or take that research, you'll only sleep because your mind cannot handle it. So what is it? It's a progression. Automatically, if you do well, you're alert in the class one, automatically you get upgraded to class two and so on and so forth. Same way, if you practice vairagya, it will lead to bodha. If you and the bodha will lead to indifference and uparati. So here it is told, if the first doesn't lead to the next, then the earlier efforts are meaningless. This is in a different context that they are saying, that if you are saying that I am practicing bodh, vairagya, and the bodh is not taking place, then you have not practiced vairagya properly. If you are saying that I have practiced, I know the self, but if that is not resulting in phalam, if it is not resulting in indifference to the world, non-indulgent, indulgement in the world, then you are not, the bodh is not correct bodh. These are the signposts given to us by Shankaracharya ji to check ourselves, not to judge others. Not to judge others. Not to pass a not a checklist, a comment that, oh, Swamiji said that, Shankaracharya said that, I think you're not being indifferent. Just because by mistake the husband said, I know. And the wife catches him. I know. Yes, yesterday you are asking for pakoda and chai. And you say, I know. You're a hypocrite. Not that way. It is to be practiced. It is about being alert about what is going on in your mind, not in other people. What is going on with the rest of the world? Leave it to the dogs. You worry about yourself. So here he says, if the first doesn't lead to the next, then the earlier efforts are meaningless. That is, without the peace of mind, withdrawal is meaningless. Without the withdrawal, experience is meaningless. Without the experience, dispassion is meaningless. So indifference is meaningless if the experience is not there. If experience is not there, dispassion is not there. And in this manner, correct your take of life. Correct, don't live in a fool's imagination that I have studied so many Upanishads, I have given so many lectures, I am a sannyasi, I am a very sattvic person, I am a very great devotee of the Lord because I have got this siddhi and that siddhi. All that is unwanted. If it is not leading to, sometimes your words also come true. You tell something and things happen. It happens. Many things keep happening like this. But that, because of that, if your ahankar is increasing, your ego is increasing about your, I think I am more realized than I was last year. Why? Because I create more confusion. Or I got more siddhis. No, it is not that way. These are the signposts. Dispassion must lead to knowledge. Knowledge must lead to indifference. If indifference is not taking place, then knowledge has not taken place correctly. If knowledge is not taking place, then vairagya has not taken place correctly. Maybe it was kshanik vairagya, shmashan vairagya. Shmashan means, you understand shmashan? Kshanik vairagya means temporary vairagya. Shmashan, another word for it is shmashan. When you go to a funeral, oh, I am also going to die like that one day. And you start, well, life is me. Why am I running after all these things? This person has gone away without anything. He's got a big portfolio, but he took away nothing with him. He could have enjoyed that. He could have lived, done, helped so many people. But he went away empty-handed. He came empty-handed. I also came empty-handed. I will also go empty-handed. For that moment, the moment you, Purnamada Purnamidam happens at the funeral parlor and you get into the car, back. Oh, that share has gone up. Let's invest. Let's sell it and cash the profit. Vairagya gone? To this extent that the partner of that person, the wife or the husband of the person who has passed away, after a year or so, they are also fine. They forget. Look at those people who are so deeply engaged with each other and married for so many years, then they divorce. And then they find another partner, they forget the first one. Dispassion. Gone the wrong way. But this is what we are practicing. We are like prostitutes going from one object to the other. For pleasure. Thinking this will satisfy me, that will satisfy me, now this will satisfy me, this will. This is what Vaishya does. We are also doing the same. So now we come to today's verse, 422nd. Repeat after me. Drishta dukheshwan udvego. Drishta dukheshwan udvego. Vidyaya prastutam phalam. Yatkrutam bhranti velayam. Nana karma jugupsitam. Panchan naro vivekena. Tatkatham kartum arhati. The real achievement of the wise man through the self-knowledge is remaining undisturbed by the memories which reach us through prarabdha. That is earlier deeds. If a person has done the unworthy deeds under the spell of delusion, how can he again repeat them, having come to discover them through discrimination? See, this is what persecutes us in life. Only two things. What? Guilt and expectations. This is pulling us away from the present. So you have to sort it out. How do you sort out the future? Karmanyevadhikaraste mahaphaleshu kadachan. You sort out the future. Why? Whenever the future will be experienced, that will be the present moment. I cannot imagine, I cannot preempt what is going to happen. So many forces are in play. So that's for the future, for guilt. They are already there, all the memories are there. How do you take it out? There's no easy way of taking it out. They are persecuting us. They are troubling us. They keep us awake at night, depending upon what memories you have or what guilts you are collected. What did he say?
Harboring
in the mind, in the subconscious mind. So what is if the realized master, here it is said, the real achievement, drushta dukheshu anudvego vidyaya prastutam phalam. How does a realized master deal with this? Because we see realized masters, they are still in their body, they are still having certain habits. Nisargadatta Maharaj used to smoke. Hmm? etc., etc. So many, everyone has something or the other. So we see them. They have a mind. Then how do they function?
They don't give any value to it.
They allow in other... What does it mean they don't give? Firstly, they are indifferent to it. Indifferent to it. Then what they are not indifferent to in the initial stages? To the self. They are totally alert and focused or available to the self that they are. To the extent they are available to the self, to that extent they are indifferent to everything else. How long they have to remain indifferent? How long they have to remain indifferent?
Not by willingly, it happens.
See, as long as complete consummation doesn't take place, they have to be alert. Otherwise, any world is so strong that it pulls you. Any one spark can light up the fire. So they have to be alert. So my question is, how long they have to be alert of the self, about the self?
Every moment.
But how long?
Till they realize.
When will they become one with it?
When they don't see the others as, there's no difference.
It's as long as existence.
So what is stopping? What is stopping them from not seeing, being? What is stopping them from being the self?
Still the vasanas go.
Till the last vasana goes away. And it is not that last vasana has to go, oh my God, now 1 million are left and I have to wait till 1 million, then only it will go. It's not like that. There are two stories about this or examples. One is that one devotee of the Lord was meditating, and as a result of meditation, automatically as the mind became quiet, he is not merged into the divine, he is thinking of Lord Narayana and he is meditating. As he is meditating, mind is becoming calm due to his surrender. And as the mind is becoming calm, automatically wealth, food, house, money, ornaments, everything is coming into his home. The neighbor sees, hey, what are you doing, man, to become so successful? He says, nothing. What are you not doing? I see you sitting in meditation every day. He says, you also sit. So he also asks, what are you doing? I think of Narayana. He also starts thinking of Narayana. But what is the purpose that he is sitting for? For getting the wealth. What is the first one sitting for? To merge into the divine. So both are getting wealth. Both got. He built a mansion also, he got money also, he got wonderful buffet food also every day. Everything, both of them are getting. One day, it so happened that Naradji was passing by. He says, hey man, Narayan Bhagavan is very happy with both of you. Tell me, the moment the first one, because the second one is a copy master. So the first one, the original meditator, he said, oh Narayan Muniji, you are as good as seeing the Lord, you got direct entry into Vaikuntha and so on. And he falls at his feet, please, when next time you go to Vaikuntha, please ask Narayana, when will I merge into him? And Narayan Muniji turned to the other one, and what do you want? Same thing what he asked, ditto. So Narayan Muniji came back. What happened, Narayan Muniji? Another year passed away, and then Narayan Muniji said, yeah, I got an answer. Both were so excited. So the answer was, they were sitting under a peepal tree. And he said, Narayan Muniji said, the as many number of leaves on this tree, that many lives you have to go through, then you will merge into the divine. The copy master, copy meditator, He said, bloody hell, I wasted this life. Now to meditate like this for that, my God, how many leaves are there? He says, that, now I'm going to enjoy the wealth that I have got. He got up and went away. But the original fellow, when he heard that as many leaves on this tree, he knows, he says that there can be only finite number of leaves on this tree. It cannot be infinite leaves. So that means Lord has given an indication that this is that many after that many number of lives, you will be free. And he went, got into ecstasy that the Lord actually gave him a straight answer. And in that ecstasy, in that thought that Lord has given him the answer, he was so lost in it that the Lord saw this is a real devotee. He immediately gave him moksha. He didn't have to wait for all the lives. This is exactly how our vasanas work. Now, second example that comes to mind is, like in this room, you can have a mountain of paper balls and you light fire. Does the fire need to go through every piece of paper ball in order to burn all the paper balls? Then what?
It can jump, it can skip.
Initially, wait,
you know the answer. Because you heard me give this example many times. So how will, it can jump, yes it can jump. But how will the total mountain of fire paper catch fire? Is it that the fire has to go through each paper ball? So what happens is that as it is going from one ball to the next paper, next paper to the next paper, a critical heat is reached within that mountain of paper. And then there is spontaneous combustion. And everything catches fire in one go. Watch the fires in Los Angeles. Or when our Dandenong was on fire. The Black Sunday. Black Wednesday, something like that. See? It is like that. Our vasanas are also, imagine, vasanas means nothing but impressions, thoughts of past. How will they burn away? Not one by one by one by one. Initially, it starts like that. But if you work on them, it will take lifetimes. But if your attention is on the knowledge, on the self, on the consciousness, you are alert towards the consciousness, the vasanas are coming up, they are asking, give me attention, you are not available, it will go away. It comes, give me attention, it goes away. If you give it attention, that vasana becomes a desire. But if you don't give it attention, it dies its own death. Then next one. And eventually it becomes so fast that in the heat of that movement, when movement is there, there is heat generated. All of them become important in one go because you are not available to them. They get credence. They get validity only when you give them attention. When they appear. How do they appear? How do you know vasana has appeared? When it appears as a thought, as a desire. And if you give it value, you become enslaved. But if you are alert towards the self, then that thought comes many times. At this time also, if you are feeling thirsty because of the heat, but you don't want to miss the the satsang, after some time, the thought of water goes away, isn't it? Exactly the same thing happens in meditation also. And it can happen 24/7, you can practice this. Remain alert towards the self, but allow the functioning to go on. because it is not you who is functioning in the world. This equipment is functioning. You remain aloof. Allow the world. You, we think we are doing the action. We think we are thinking. Thinking is going on. Thinking is producing the action. That is also by its own accord. You don't create hunger. It comes by itself. Hunger comes because of breathing. You didn't create breathing. It happens by itself. And when hunger is at its peak, then automatically you move towards the food. No thought required there. Automatically it happens. See, so many times, all of you are sitting, how many times you have shifted your position? Were you aware of changing the position? You are so engrossed, but position is getting changed, activity is happening. So did you consciously do the activity or it just happened? See, this is exactly what happens in meditation also. When you are focused, meditation means not a special position, but if you are living with alertness 24/7 about towards the self as the self, then let whatever is going on, let it go on. No qualms about it.
So if the vasanas make you do something, which you know
wrong statement. Mm. They cannot make you do something.
Mm.
Because you are not there. Mm. You are with the self. They can make you do something if you are available to them. Means your attention is on them. You understand? So where are vasanas happening? In the mind. So intellect, mind, breath, body is the equipment. And there this whole drama is going on. Let it go on. You did not create the body. Let it go on. It's the phenomena. Let it happen. Why unnecessarily identify with the phenomena and take the load of the phenomena and then beat yourself up? I have committed, I have got subconscious impressions, I have got this, I have got that. If you come to Amrita Anubhava, there is no talk of, only Shankaracharya talks about vasana. Amrita Anubhava, no talk of vasana. Not, there is nothing called vasana. Vasana is only a theoretical equation to prove to you that you are responsible for your actions. Because our itch is there. I am doing this. I got my duty. I got my children. I got my family. Blah, 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 everything. And we, so that you don't blame anyone in this world for how you find yourself at this moment in life. Don't blame anyone. Take full responsibility. For that purpose, this concept of vasana has been created. Vasana is not a reality. Reality is only one thing, and that is the self. Everything else is just a concept. Concepts change. If a person, the real achievement of the wise man through the self knowledge is remaining undisturbed by the memories which reach us through prarabdha, that is earlier deeds. So don't get disturbed by whatever mind is throwing up. And as the mind becomes calm, deeper things come out which you may not, you may not even know that they existed there. But they will come out. Why? Because you have an idea, you have a concept that there is past life. You have a concept that, you know, after so, I must have done some punya in my past life. Therefore, I got the opportunity to come to satsang, that I got love for the Lord, that I understand Upanishads, etc., etc. This is how you have been taught also. And you believe it. It is good you believe it. But now that belief is also a concept. It has to be cancelled. It has to be cancelled. So if a person has done the unworthy deeds under the spell of delusion, how can he repeat them, having come to discover them through discrimination? So if for any reason you do become aware of some unwanted acts that you have done from the past, forgive yourself completely. If in your mind someone else has tricked you, forgive themselves completely. Why? For whatever acts you have done in your dream, you forgive yourself. Forgive meaning we are going more than that, forgiveness. We are indifferent to it because we know it does not exist. Exactly the same way, past does not exist. Then what exists? This moment alone. This moment alone, past does not exist. Until you feel that you need to resolve this, you need to resolve this. Agar wo keeda hai, if that virus is there, you are attracting it. But if you want to, because see, there are different ways. If you do pranayam, you do kumbhak, you can bring it about to a quiet. Your mind will become quiet. Your mind will become quiet. For temporarily, your vasanas have become silent. But they become silent in sleep also, only to come back the next day when you wake up, isn't it? So what has happened? They have become unmanifest. Here we don't want them to become unmanifest. Then we want to annihilate them. We want to obliterate them. And the only way to do that is by becoming, whether they are there or not there. Who says they are there and not there? The worldly people say that. Worldly people say that. Your mind is not available to them. Your mind is focused on the self. Whether they are there or not there, your attention is not going in that direction. Because even a teeny, meeny idea, I have been focused for a long time on this, my mind has been calm, I hope nothing troubles me afterwards. Gone. That very moment it will start. Because that thought came. They say nothing lasts forever. See how we cancel ourselves. Nothing lasts forever. They say if you are happy, don't be too happy, because then sorrow will come. And when the sorrow comes, they say this will also pass away. Then happiness will come. But we are not getting caught up in this belief. We are coming to the conviction that we are of the nature of Satchitanand. There's no coming and going. There's no swaying. There's no oscillation. That is the self. But at the worldly level, this oscillation will continue. Don't get disturbed by it. And that oscillation is on account of your prarabdha, on account of your vasanas. So how do you not get disturbed? By not giving it importance, not by remaining indifferent to it. Why has disease come? Why is the back aching? Why is whatever going on? Prepare yourself. Paschan naro vivekena tat katham kartum arhati. If a person has done unworthy deeds under the spell of delusion, a person who is drunk with alcohol and in that drunken state he has smashed windows, he has scratched the cars, he has abused the people. Once he has become sober, will he perform those type of acts? Will he? And if people tell, hey, you did all that, will he accept? What he will say? That was not me. That was a drunken fellow. I am not like that. Think. Now, under the spell of ignorance, where you thought you were the individual, you performed many acts which were right or wrong. And now, you, because of that, certain impressions were created. Once you raise your bar and you have come to establish in the self, now you have become sober. Knowledge has taken place. Vairagya leads to bodha. Now the bodha is there. Will you say that I am the same person who was living at the objective level? Just like, will a sober person ever say or perform those type of acts after becoming sober? Never. Opportunity is there, but he will never, because he was drunk. So when we raise ourselves or we become aware of ourselves, will we perform the way we are performing right now? It is not possible. For other people, this thought also is impossible. It's actually for that sober fellow, it is a wonderful, really I did all that. My God, I can't believe it. Similarly, a realized master, oh, did I do the sadhana? I can't, there's nothing to do sadhana for. There's nothing to run away from. Oh, they said, vairagya, vairagya. Oh, okay, okay. This is what I did. Think about it. Then, like that fellow who was playing with the toys when he was young, now he plays with the toys after grown up, after being grown up with his children. But what is his attitude towards the toys now? Is it the same as when he was young? It is my toy, I will not share it with anyone. But now, he plays with total indifference towards the toys. It is only to entertain that kid, isn't it? There is no attachment towards the toys. He is doing the leela. He will make the child cry, he will make the child laugh, he will act like a child with the child. We all do that. Because he's acting like a child with the child, he has not become a child. He's just playing the role. Or the role is being played through him. Exactly the same way. The realized master also, wherever life is placing that particular equipment, the role is played. Something has to come. If someone comes, someone gives a mantra, another remains silent, another one gives a slap, another one gives they will increase, bloat his ego till he crashes, different ways. What is going to come out, he also doesn't know. It all depends upon who is in front, because he is empty. He is empty of the world, he is full of self, he is full of divinity. Or divinity has filled him because he has become empty. And that divinity, then now, depending upon what comes in front, that alone gets reflected back to that person. Just like when you go in front of a mirror, who will get reflected? Yourself. But if you are disheveled, oh, I was looking so smart before, what happened? I think mirror is not right. Aray, Baba, you have not taken shower, that's why you are looking, reflection is like this, isn't it? Exactly the same way. Masters don't choose to give this answer or that answer. They are not a person oriented. The person in front of the masters invokes the answer out of them. But that depends upon that person, with what bhavana he is going there, with what reverence he or she is going there. How much available they are. In this class also, if bodh has to take place, how much available you are? How much available I am to myself to allow the words to flow? See? these things click when we practice vairagya. Vairagya leads to bodha. Bodha leads to indifference. And a person who is indifferent will not have sankalpas or vikalpas within his mind. Because he is not world-oriented. He is not extrovert. Sankalpa vikalpa comes only when you are focused on the world. Vitya phalam syad sato nivruttihi. Phalam syad sato nivruttihi. Pravrittir ajnana phalam tadikshitam. Pravrittir ajnana phalam pradikshitam. Tadjnanagnyor yan mrugatrushnikadau. Tadjnanagnyauryan mrutatrushnikadau. Tadjnanagnyauryan mrugatrushnikadau. No chedvido drushtafalam kimasmat. No ched vidho, vidho drishta phalam kimasmat. The result of wisdom is withdrawal from the unreal. See, these are just different words. First it was told indifferent to the unreal. Now it is told withdrawal from the unreal. Both mean the same thing. But which word will impress your mind, the teacher doesn't know. So he's using different words so that it clicks. So many scriptures are there talking about the same thing in so many different ways. But allow, if we are available, then something will click suddenly. So here he says, the result of wisdom is withdrawal. And what is wisdom? Being established in the self is wisdom. When the bodha, atma bodha happens as a result of vairagya. Vairagya leads to vivek, vivek leads to atma bodha. See, again I'll tell you, vairagya leads to thinning of the mind. In that thinning of the mind, bodha automatically emanates and eventually you get established in it. And the result of wisdom is withdrawal from the unreal. For such a person, now unreal has got no meaning. He is not obsessed with it anymore. He is not pursuing it anymore. And that of the ignorance is to get involved in the unreal. Now watch, what are we doing? Are we involved in the unreal? What is unreal? That which is changing, that which is impermanent. So are we involved in the unreal? Or are we involved in the real? If your attention, again we'll come back to the same thing. If your attention is on my words that are coming to your ears, words are changing. Words are changing. Three different words I used already. So what is unreal? That which is changing. So is your attention on the words? If it is on the meaning also, you have lost the plot. You lost the plot. Because every word is giving different meaning. Or is your attention on that because of which listening is possible? Then you are on the real principle. If your attention is on the listening, then you are on the unreal principle. But it must happen slowly. You can't force yourself. You have to keep this awareness in your mind that I must come to the principle because of which hearing is possible. Every now and then, bring yourself back to base. Bring yourself back to base. Slowly, 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 slowly. As your mind thins, as your mind understands that, yes, these words are important. Because we think only by listening, understanding will take place. But here in satsang, we are here to change your notions about yourself. You are of the nature of knowledge. You don't have to collect knowledge. bodha or wisdom is not through words, it is your nature. And we forget that every now and then. Well, majority of the time we forget. So, satsang is a environment where you are reminded again and again. Come back to base in spite of the listening. Don't get lost in listening. Then you are doing true shravanam. Then mananam nididhyasana, if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't happen, doesn't matter. But for this 1.5 hours, with such concentration you are sitting, with such focus, availability you are sitting, you cannot sit by yourself. Very rare. We'll go on the fan, or we'll grab a tea, or we'll 10 times we'll sip some water. Huh? Or we'll call this one, hey, have you done this? Oh, have you done that? Oh, see how fantastic thought came to me. You will share. You will never remain that focused as you are for 1.5 hours in this class. So take advantage of it. And here we are not telling you to build temples or... no, we are taking you... Vivekachudamani is taking you straight back to... without any... beating around the bush, straight back to the source. These two results are obviously seen in the wise and the otherwise persons by their withdrawal and participation in the illusions of the mirage, etc., respectively. If this difference is not seen, what is the fruit of wisdom? So, just like some people, you must have experienced. Some people look at the mirage and they remain still. Other people who are very thirsty, especially in the desert, they look at the mirage and they run after the mirage, never to catch the waters to drink and eventually die, isn't it? Exactly the same way. Wise men are sthitapragna. They watch this mirage of the world. They have got no desire for this world. Just like you don't have a desire for the mirage, to drink the waters of the mirage waters, they don't have the desire to drink, indulge, associate with anything in this world out of desire. You see them getting involved, but it is out of desire. It is happening. Prarabdhavash. And who are the ignorant ones? They are not established, they are running after the mirage to satisfy themselves. This is the difference. And this is what we must become alert about within our life. That are we running after the world, or are we established in the self and looking at this world with discrimination, that this world can never give me the satisfaction that I need. So we dive back into the self even with more gusto, with more availability. Every now and then, some deep desire, very potent desire, may pull you out of yourself and take you in that direction. Catch it, come back again. Neutralize it. That it's a mirage. If this difference is not seen, what is the fruit of wisdom? This is the difference that we see in Mahatmas and among common men, ignorant people. If someone dies, your child is born, party, 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 party. Isn't it? One person just yesterday, he came, brought some Diwali sweets. Swamiji, now we are, my daughter has got into a special school. She got into Macrom. And their very wife's very good friend, her daughter did not get into Macrom. She also gave the exam. His daughter also gave the exam. Now, that other family, they have become jealous. How come your daughter got into microbe and how come my daughter did not get into microbe? And that family has stopped talking to this family. And he came with me to Kailash. Oh, you must have prayed to Kailash and you must not have prayed for our daughter at Kailash. Are? They're finding all reasons. So now to show that they are not, their daughter is also smart, they got her into a very expensive private school. What is this? This is competition. This is comparison. Isn't it? Will you say such a person is established? What can you? Can you control that person? So this person was disturbed. That my wife is very close friend, the bestest friend, and now she's not talking to her. What do we do? I said, you don't get involved. You watch the drama unfold. If at all, you increase her confidence that she'll make more friends. It is only out of attachment. You become familiar with certain set of people because you associate with them for a long period of time, isn't it? So if this difference is not seen, what is the fruit of wisdom? Ajnana hridaya granthehe. Ajnana hridaya granthehe. Avinasho yadyasheshataha. Sho yadyasheshataha. Anechhor vishaya kinnu. Anechhor vishaya kinnu. Pravritte karanam swataha. So here he says, when the knot of ignorance of the heart, ignorance, desire and karma is fully destroyed for such a person who is free from all desires, can the worldly objects by themselves become the cause of attraction for? Meaning, how long will this prarabdha go on? How long will this, you feel in deep meditation, your mind is empty, you are focused on the self, you are in samadhi, but eventually you come out of samadhi, isn't it? Sometimes you feel you are all calm, cool, collected, nothing can disturb you. And then something untoward happens and it breaks your resolve, isn't it? And it catches you unaware. It comes with such a force from inside. Sometimes it's passion, sometimes it's anger, sometimes it's jealousy. What do you have to do then? Here, they have said, and see, bhidyate, it comes, bhidyate hridaya granthi. You have to cut this knot of the heart. This is not the bloody heart, it is the hridaya granthi. It is a knot which is existing in its own absence. And what is that? Ajnana, ignorance, leads to kama, desire. And desire leads to karma, activity, action. Now, ignorance leads to, where? Ignorance, what is ignorance? Where has ignorance come about from? Ignorance is beginningless, because you don't know when it began. Then what is ignorance? What is ignorance? Correct. Not what is true and know. Not and what is true. Not knowing the truth leads to ignorance. The moment light comes up, darkness goes away. The moment truth shines, ignorance vanishes. If ignorance vanishes, its child and its grandchild, desire and action, if ignorance is gone, they are also gone. You understand? This is the cutting asunder of the hridaya granthi. So where are we working on? Are we working, when you go step by step, Bhagavad Gita, first 6 chapters, karma yoga, next 6 chapters Bhakti Yoga, last 6 chapters Jnana Yoga. When you go to Ashtanga Yoga, Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, Pratyahara, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi, then Kevala Samadhi. When you go through Kundalini, Muladhar, Swadhisthan, Manipur, Anahat, Vishuddhi, Agya and Sahasrar. When you go, follow the Sri Chakra Puja, the 16 Kalas you have to go through. So these are all step by step methods. So they are first dealing with karma, then they deal with their desire, and then they come to establish in the self. So here what are we doing? We are straight away going to the foundation. We are saying karma, desire and ignorance. If you are involved in removing them, you are still in ignorance. Because all activity of doing is the grandchild of ignorance. If you are doing japa, sadhana, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, that is also a product of ignorance only, because it's change. So how do you, then should we not practice? Should we not do sadhana? Because it is a product of ignorance, it's just doing sadhana. Then what do we do? How do you find a middle way or balance, or how do we do it? On one hand you say, go to the foundation, and other hand you are saying, anything that I do is a product of ignorance.
You still have to do it at the beginning. Then
doing is to quieten the mind.
With the sadhana, eventually this will get rid of the desire. And
just drop by itself.
Karma frees the mind.
Karma frees the mind.
The
Nishkam karma. So when you say karma, karma doesn't free the mind. Nishkam karma frees the mind.
The knowledge is the...
Yeah, but when you are saying here he is saying, come to the self. Come to the self. Everything, the Hridaya Granthi will dissolve by itself. But then, at where we are at this moment, then that means I don't have to come to satsang, I don't have to read the books, I don't have to do any sadhana, or what? I don't have to do the name, or take the name of the Lord also, then what? But then the knowledge is telling you, contemplate on the truth.
Yeah, different type of
not on the action, not on the desire, not on removing the expressions of ignorance, which is desire and action. And action happens at 3 levels, manasa, vacha, kaya. See how deep the hole is.
Desireless desires.
Yeah. Explain.
But when we do these actions with the knowledge of the self, that is attached to the self.
Good, Amma. Very good. That is the only way. That let everything happen. If you are clicked into taking the name of the Lord, let the mind take the name of the Lord. But your attention is on the Lord itself. Not on the mantra coming and going. In that one, it will be the bhava with which you remember the divine while taking the name. What that name represents, you are thinking about that. When you are thinking about contemplating on the self, still, I'm also talking here, there's activity going on, but where is my attention? Is my attention on you, or is it on the self and talking is happening? It's a very fine line. Nothing needs to stop, or nothing does not need to not stop. Because gati or activity is not, you are not initiating the activity. It is happening. Prarabdhavash. So as many times during the day you can come back to the conscious principle, come back to that which does not change within you, come back to that because of which this life is being is happening to you, that because of which all the senses, mind and intellect are functioning, that because of which you call yourself alive, not dead. Come back to be that, not come back, be that again and again. Bring your attention to that principle again and again. Uncle, time kya hai? Time. So in this manner, this is the way to break the Hridaya Granthi. This Hridaya Granthi cannot be broken merely by activity, merely by indulging in the desires or not indulging the desires, because these two become absent when you are in sleep also. But does the Granthi break? In sleep there is no activity. In sleep there is no desire. But does the knot break? It doesn't break, because you are still in under the influence of ignorance. So only light can break that darkness. Therefore, what is that? Tamaso ma jyotirgamaya. From ignorance to light, from darkness to light, from ignorance to consciousness. We'll see the last one next week. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for a minute.